was like, is it just like push the thing down?
That would be hilarious. You should have done
if
that.
If I forget to do it this time, that's this universal signal that you should all be giving.
Just saying. And pedal.
All right.
Stretch those legs, get into the groove. It's a good groove. Clapping wouldn't hurt. That's it.
You're arriving with the sound of thunder and rain.
Defeated the grave, raised to life.
is on our side. He will make a way. Above all we know, far above all we hope, He has done great things. Lifted up, He defeated the grave.
Morning, Timberline. Go ahead and grab a seat this morning. It is good to be in this nice, warm city of Des Moines, Iowa, anticipating some more great weather. Is everybody excited? It's 41. I mean, what am I complaining about, right? I mean, hey, my hair didn't even get messed up this morning with that wind. Well, it's fun to live here. It's fun to have some fun. It's fun to get together, and it's great to worship our Lord and Savior. Amen? Well, if you're new with us, we are especially glad you're here with us this morning. We want to invite you to a luncheon next Sunday. We call it a walk through the timbers. It follows this service. So if you haven't, if you're new with us and you haven't come to that luncheon, plan to join us, all right? It's at 12:15, lasts for about an hour and 15 minutes, hour and a half. Yes, Lord? I guess that's exclamation point to do that. All right, so here's the deal. If you would take your program, tear that off on the edge of your program, fill that out, how many is going to join us for lunch next week, and drop that little slip in what we call the joy box between our worship center doors as you leave later on today. We'll make sure we have plenty of food for us when we gather. All right. A couple of announcements for us and one update. February the 9th, we have our baptism Sunday. We have a number of people lined up to get baptized. We're excited about what God's doing in our midst. And if you have not been baptized, if you've come to know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, one of the first things He has commissioned us to do in obedience is to visually align ourselves with Him through what we call believer's baptism. And so if that describes you, you know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, and you haven't obeyed the Spirit's promptings to get baptized, we invite you to tell us today, and we will help you. It grabs Pastor Steve, myself, Pastor Don, and we will help you prepare for the special service February 9th. As a side note, we are doing both baptisms, both first service and second service. You don't have to do them both, but we'll be having them in both services, all right? Men. Part of our spiritual formation here at Timberline to grow in our walk with the Lord, we provide men's groups here at Timberline. Since the beginning of Timberline, we've done them on Wednesdays. We've done things like men's fraternity, and we just began something called 33. It has a flavor like Men's Fraternity, but it's radically different. It's A Man and His Traps, and it's a great series. It's only a 6-week series, and we're going to start doing them not on Wednesdays, but on Tuesdays starting February the 11th. If you want to learn more, I just encourage you to show up to the first one, February 11th, and give it a test drive. And by the way, compared to previous years, you get to sleep in an extra 15 minutes because we won't start till 6:15. All right, that's right, exactly right. So, and you'll be done plenty of time to go to work. So, Tuesday, February 11. Gospel class, for those pursuing through the gospel classes, gospel class number 2 is actually next week at 1:30. See Pastor Steve for more details on that, but we invite you to come be part of the gospel class there as well. Okay. Lastly, I want to give you an update as a church body. Many of us remember Brandon and Nikki Jordan. Brandon was able to join us probably pushing a year ago now. They have been missionaries in the country of Haiti. Many of us have had the opportunity to minister right alongside of their family, the Jordan family there in Haiti. Brandon came and shared with us what God was doing in his life, in their life, and in their ministry. And what God was leading them to was a time of rest and retooling and refreshment. And that's what they've been doing. They're living in the southern states right now, really on a time of sabbatical. And because of your faithfulness as a body, they were able to financially make that transition because they had lost most of their support. And because of your faithfulness, they've been able to do this. And so they've sent us an update. I just want to share with you just a couple of sentences out of this update and invite you to pray and how you can respond as a body, how we all can respond. All right. First of all, in their letter, Brandon says this: as of right now, our family is our primary focus. We've been amazed at how God has given us a new hope, a new joy through openness and communication and expression of our desires and of our dreams. We're seizing the opportunity to be fed and grow as a husband and wife, as a mother and father, and it's been amazing. We're looking at new avenues of life and love and of our passions in our family as well as in our ministry. And so we invite you to pray for the Jordan family. In this time, they have served faithfully in Haiti, planted multiple churches, and gone through a lot of stuff over the years. So pray for them in this process, and that God would continue just to lead them and clearly show where he wants them to go and what he's asking of them to do. And secondly, in his letter, he mentioned that finances are tight, but they'll survive. But one challenge they do have is he wants to go back. He feels led to go back to Haiti multiple times this year to go help the latest church plant that they had planted before coming back. And they don't have the money for flights back and forth to Haiti. And he wondered, is anybody able to help them with the flight costs? Or maybe you have frequent flyer miles that you'll never be able to use. You just want to donate to them. If that describes you as you pray, I invite you, let me know, and I'll get you connected directly to Brandon so you can work out those details. All right? But praise God for the work he's done through you and what he's doing in the Jordan family. Let's pray as we continue our time of worship this morning. Father, Lord, it is good to be back here together to sing your praises. Lord, I pray as we gather, Lord, that our sacrifice of praise would be glorifying to you. Lord, that we would be ready to meet with you one-to-one right where we're at this morning. And Father, we lift up the Jordan family. We thank you for the ministry you've used them to, that you called them to in Haiti. And Lord, give them the rest that they need and provide their basic needs that they need to continue the ministry you've called them to, whatever that is and wherever that looks like and whatever it is. We pray your blessing upon it. And Father, Lord, now as we come and we offer up our praise and sacrifice to you, Lord, we pray that you'd meet us where we're at and it would be a beautiful offering, a holy worship to our one true King, our God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. And all God's people said, amen.
Thanks, Gary. All right, I'm going to ask you guys a question, and I want you to be really, really honest with yourselves and with me, okay? and you don't have to respond, and I don't want you to cheer. I don't want you to do anything. And it's kind of a rhetorical question, but kind of not. But the question is, are you ready to worship? And I'm not asking, are you ready to stand up and sing some songs and have some fun? I'm asking, are you ready to worship the living God who creates universes with his word? Have you had a chance this morning to just reflect on who he is? Have you spent some time just confessing to him? Have you been able to lay all of the anxieties and all the worries and all the stress and all the things that happen in your day-to-day lives before him today? Because if you are ready to worship, we're going to sing some songs. And every word, every note is going to glorify him. We're going to lift it up as an offering. But if you need to take a moment right now, I'm just going to start playing. If you need to take a moment to just bow your head and do some business with God before you even open your mouth and utter a word unto him, I want to give you guys the opportunity to do that. So what we're going to do is I'm just going to start playing a little bit. You guys just bow your heads. Then we're just going to softly start worshiping. And then as you're ready to join and as you're ready to exalt the King, just stand with us, okay? You go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Whom you love, I love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow you. Where you go, I'll go. And where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. Follow you, whom you love, I love, how you serve, I serve. If this life I lose, I will follow you.
I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you
life I live, I will follow you.
Psalm 56. This is a psalm of David. He says, "Be gracious to me, O God, for man tramples on me. All day long, an attacker oppresses me. My enemies trample on me all day long, for many attack me proudly. When I am afraid, I put my trust in you, in God, whose word I praise. In God I trust. I shall not be afraid. What can flesh do to me?"
If my God is with me, shout, shout it out. Oh no, you never let go. Through the cold and through the storm. Oh no, you never let go. Every high and every low. Oh no, you never let go. Lord, you never let go of me. And I can see a light that is coming for the heart that holds on. A glorious light beyond compare.
Sing out this hope.
There will be an end to these troubles, but until that day comes, we'll live to know you here on the earth. And I will fear no evil, for my God is with me. And if my God is with me, whom then shall I? The heart that holds on, and there will be an end to these troubles, but until that day comes, still I will praise you, still I will praise you. Yes, I can see a light that is coming for the heart that holds on. There will be troubles, but until that day comes, still I will praise you, still I will praise you, yeah. Oh no, you never let go, through the calm and through the storm. Oh no, you never let go, every high and every low. Oh no, you never let go. Lord, you never let go of me. Oh no, you never let go. Through the calm and through the storm. Oh no, you never let go. Every high and every low. Oh no, you never let go. Lord, you never let go. Hold my every moment. You calm my raging seas. You walk with me through fire and heal all my disease. trust in you. I trust in you. And I believe you're my healer. I believe you are all I need. And I believe you're my portion. And I believe you're more than enough for me. Jesus, you're all I need. You hold every moment, all my raging seas. You walk with me through fire.
Father, we would ask that you would let that truth settle into our hearts, that that would become a reality for each one of us, that you and you alone are all we need. Father, we sang this morning that you never let go. And we would ask that even in the midst of confusing and difficult life circumstances, you would help us to begin to realize that that also is true of you. You never let go of your children. And so, Father, we would ask is that you would speak to us from the text today, that you would reinforce from your word these truths for us. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Well, we are starting a new section in the book of 1 Samuel this morning. We've entitled this section, Behind Enemy Lines, because David is about to go behind enemy lines, and he's going to be there for the next 7 years. We're going to look, as we look at the text, we're going to see that David has stopped trusting in God, and he has started trusting in himself. He actually started that back in chapter 20. Continues to live that out. He is trusting in himself. Now, I know nobody in this room has ever taken their eyes off of God before in their time on this earth. Certainly, we would never do that, right? We do it all the time. It's easy, isn't it? Have you ever noticed? And all you got to do is take your eyes off the Lord for like a nanosecond, and it's a slippery slope into yuck. And we start coming up with our own plans, and we start coming up with our own schemes, and our life very rapidly can unravel and fall apart. You ever found yourself in that type of situation? And you find yourself in some very, very difficult circumstances. Sometimes the circumstances found you first, and the temptation, where's God? And I got to solve this myself, and we relegate God to the sidelines. You know, that's just genetically wired into us, guys. That's the default mode that we all fall into, myself included. And so when we get in those types of situations, have you ever made a deal with yourself that goes something along these lines? Okay, you got your eyes off of God. Things are a mess. We're confused. And maybe we're doing things that we know that maybe God wouldn't approve of or doesn't exactly line up, but it seems to be getting us back to where we think we should be. And so we keep doing it. And maybe, you know, God lets us get away with it. And it seems like it's working. And we make, this is the deal. If I could just get back to this point, if life could just get back to some sort of sense of normalcy and okayness, God, then I'll knock this other stuff off and I'll really start behaving. You ever made that deal? I can recite that so well because I'm good at making that deal with God. Never turns out well. That's the type of situation David's in. It reminds me a little bit of a game that I used to play with people. I don't do it anymore. I've matured a little. And the game would go something like this. You get a volunteer or victim, and you have them sit down and say, okay, I want to play along. This is really cool. This is awesome, okay? And I'm going to tell this story, and I'm going to do some things to kind of help make it more real to you. Okay. And you put your hands on either side of their ears, and then you start moving your hands back and forth like this. And you say, okay, here's the deal. You're walking through a forest, and my hands are the trees going by, okay? Okay. And then you hear a noise behind you, and you get a little scared. So you start kind of jogging through the forest, and then you think you hear a growl, and so you start running through the forest. Okay, now close your eyes. And as soon as they close their eyes, you knock them right in the forehead. Okay, do one of these. And you go, that'll teach you to run through a forest with your eyes closed. Now, don't do that. You can hurt somebody by doing that. Okay, this is not the application. Hey, I heard in church today. Check this out. No. Applications later. We're going to get to the application. That's just an illustration that that's how a lot of us do life. We're running through the forest with our eyes closed. And then we're stunned when we smack our head, right? Kind of like David today. So if you have your Bibles, take a look at 1 Samuel chapter 21. David and Jonathan, at the end of chapter 20, they've said goodbye. They've had their tearful farewell. David is now on the run for his life. If Saul finds him, if any of Saul's spies find him, he is a dead man. And so he's running for his life. And we pick it up here. Then David came to Nob, to Ahimelech, the priest. And Ahimelech came to meet David, trembling, and said to him, "Why are you alone and no one with you?" Ahimelech knows something's up. Because we'll see, he's got a few companions with him, but not much. And the priest is like, something's not right here. And David said to Ahimelech, the priest, "The king has charged me with a matter and said to me, 'Let no one know anything of the matter about which I send you and with which I have charged you. I have made an appointment with the young men for such and such a place. Now then, what do you have on hand? Give me 5 loaves of bread or whatever is here.' And the priest answered David, 'I have no common bread on hand, but there is the holy bread, if the young men have kept themselves from women.' And David answered the priest, 'Truly women have been kept from us always when I go on an expedition. The vessels of the young men are holy even when it is an ordinary journey. How much more today will their vessels be holy?' So the priest gave him the holy bread, for there was no bread there but the bread of the presence, which is removed from before the Lord to be replaced by hot bread on the day that it is taken away." The priest comes out, knows something's amiss, and says, "Why are you alone?" And so David looks him square in the eye and lies to him. Again. And again, the scriptures are silent. There's no rebuke from the Lord in this chapter or subsequent chapters, and we find ourselves scratching, well, so is it okay under circumstances, right? We've been wrestling this for several weeks. Still not going to answer it today. Although you might, as you wrestle with it, you might put into the crock pot of your brain, how does our belief in God's sovereignty inform the answer about lying? We're going to get to that in a few more chapters. We're going to let David keep lying his tail off and see where it gets him. So watch the consequences as we go along. But we're not going to answer that today. The priest knows there's something up. David lies straight to his face, fabricates a story that Saul sent him on some sort of secret special mission, and so therefore help me out. Now, have you ever been in a situation where someone is lying to you? And you know, okay, something's just not right about this, but I can't quite put my finger on it. And you want to give them the benefit of the doubt. I mean, you want to trust them. I mean, after all, this is David who killed Goliath. I mean, he's like national hero, right? But have you ever been in that type of situation? Oftentimes it happens in parenting. I remember one time when one of our children was 2, 3 years old, right around there. And I'd given him a sandwich. I left the room for a moment, came back, sandwich is gone. And I'm like, "What happened to your sandwich?" And they're like, "I ate it." And I'm like, "Mm-hmm." Walk over to the kitchen. Every Midwestern home has the garbage can under the sink, right? Pull that, and there's a sandwich with one bite out of it. And I'm like, "Did you not like it?" "No, well, you could have just said, right?" It's kind of where the priest is at. He can kind of sense that there's a sandwich somewhere with one bite missing. He just can't quite put his finger on it. And so he says, "Well, all I've got is the bread of the presence. Also, it's the show bread in the tabernacle." And so we assume because of this that the tabernacle is at Nob. We know the ark was put on the shelf back in, you know, it's in storage back in chapter 5, chapter 6 of 1 Samuel. But here's the tabernacle. And you have the Holy of Holies, which only the high priest can go once a year. But the other room in there is the holy place. And in there, there's the lampstand and the table, the show table. And so this table is where this bread would be put, 12 loaves, one for each of the tribes of Israel. It'd be there for a week. And then once a week, the old would be removed and fresh, warm bread would be there to replace it. And remind that God is the provider. And the priest says, "Well, we don't have any regular bread, but we do have this. We have the show bread." So if you guys have not been with women, then you can have it. Now, the priest is not anti-woman. He's just pragmatic. These are men. They're married. More than likely, they're having sex. That would make you ceremonially unclean according to the law. And if that's the case, you can't have the show bread. That's all he's saying. Got to be ceremonially clean. That's the point. David's like, promise you, we are. Okay, you can have the bread. The Lord Jesus even refers back to the story in the New Testament when his disciples are accused of breaking the Sabbath, right? Working on the Sabbath because they pulled a couple heads of grain to feed themselves because they were hungry. And David goes, well, haven't you read about David? David ate the bread that was set aside just for the priests, because when the bread came out, it was for the Levites. Only the priests could eat it, but yet here's the priest giving it to David, who's not a priest. And so we learn something about the law. Human life is holier than the law. And so because these men are in a situation where they may starve to death, the priest concludes that this is the holy, God-honoring thing to do. And Jesus reaffirmed his decision. So he gives them the bread. And then we have this verse 7, which the writer of 1 Samuel kind of tosses this in here. It seems like completely out of place. It will become extremely important 2 weeks from now. So I'm not gonna get into it a whole lot. I don't want to steal Gabe's thunder. Gabe's gonna be preaching. Gabe Wave, our one of our church planters in Dallas Center. I'm gonna be in Romania, so Gabe's gonna be filling the pulpit that week. But notice what it says. It says, "Now a certain man of the servants of Saul was there that day, detained before the Lord. His name was Doeg the Edomite, the chief of Saul's herdsmen." So for now, as David's here in front of the priest, lying to him about the secret mission to Saul, here's Doeg, the chief of Saul's herdsmen, present, hearing all of this. That is going to come into play in a not good way, and we'll cover that in a couple of weeks. So just kind of tuck that away. Just make a note. Oh, wait a minute. There's a spy of Saul's in the midst of this situation. So the storyteller is kind of like, okay, there's a little dark cloud on the horizon. And he'll explain it as the story progresses. Verse 8, "Then David said to Ahimelech, 'Then have you not here a spear or a sword at hand? For I have brought neither my sword nor my weapons with me, because the king's business required haste.' And the priest said, 'The sword of Goliath, the Philistine, whom you struck down in the valley of Elah, behold, it's here wrapped in a cloth behind the ephod. If you will take that, take it. For there is none but that here.' And David said, 'There is none like that. Give it to me.'" Okay, clue number 2, that there's a sandwich with a bite missing. You are the captain of the king's bodyguard, and you have no sword on you? You have nothing? I mean, give this priest high marks for grace points towards David. To go, all right, if you say so. Got Goliath's sword. Probably should have been yours anyway, right? There you go. And David takes it. Now notice, okay, here's where we start to see that David is, that he's not thinking straight at all. David rose and fled that day from Saul and went to Achish, the king of Gath. And the servants of Achish said to him, "Is not this David the king of the land? Did they not sing to one another of him in dances? Saul has struck down his thousands and David his 10,000s. David runs to Gath, which is whose hometown? Anybody remember? Goliath. David seeks asylum in Goliath's hometown. And he shows up with his sword, which I'm sure was real easy to conceal, and it was a very inconspicuous sword, right? Not. This thing was huge. So he goes to the hometown to ask the king, you know, for asylum, for protection from Saul. And so the men seize him, bring him before the king and go, "Hey, is this not the king of the land?" I mean, they recognize, it's kind of interesting. I don't know if they realize what they're saying, but he is the true king. He is the incoming king. He's the one that's been acting like the king. Isn't this the king of the land? And they've been listening to, you know, Casey Kasem's Top 40 on Israel radio, but there's this Top 40 song about how David has, or Saul has killed his thousands and David his 10,000s, right? They know about him. And at that moment, I just dated myself with Casey Kasem, didn't I? Is he still even top 40 still? Probably not. And David has a moment of clarity. He hasn't been thinking straight. In fact, we could look at this whole situation and say, okay, you remember King David? Killed Goliath in chapter 17. National hero. I mean, the guy could do no wrong. We get to the end of chapter 21, and the man, under the pressures that have been put on him, has completely dissolved. And he's standing there before the king in Goliath's hometown with Goliath's sword strapped on. And these men say, hey, isn't this the dude that they say has, you know, Saul killed his thousands, but David his 10,000s? That would be 10,000s of Philistines. That would be us. Oh, Mr. King. And at that point, David had to be thinking, oh, crud. Because now if anybody had a reason and justification to kill David, it would be this man. And he has the authority to do it. And all of a sudden, David's going, what am I doing here? How did we get here? You ever ask that question? You know, when you get your eyes off God, you know, how did I get here? That moment of clarity. And here it is. It's in the text. And David took these words to heart. There it is. Moment of clarity. Oh, no. And was much afraid of Achish, the king of Gath. So he changed his behavior before them and pretended to be insane in their hands and made marks on the doors at the gate and let his spittle run down his beard. Then Achish said to his servants, behold, you see the man is mad. Why have you brought him to me? Do I lack madmen that you have brought this fellow to behave as a madman in my presence? So this fellow come into my house. In other words, am I low on my quota of madmen? And in my studies this week as I was reading, I came across some cultural information that in the day, it was thought that someone who was mad, that was due to demonic activity from the gods. And to do something to the madman meant offending the demon, and thereby you ran the risk of offending the gods and invite retribution upon yourself. And so therefore, if someone was insane, you just kind of wanted to keep the stand. You just, If that's true, if that's what, you know, it was true, it is a cultural thing. If it's true that David was thinking about that, it would explain his behavior. He culturally understood the Philistines, their superstitions about this type of stuff. And as soon as he has his moment of clarity, I thought Saul was going to kill me. I'm in real trouble here. So he shifts his behavior, and it works. And the king's like, he's a madman. Get him away from me. I don't want to offend my gods. Send him on his way. And here's our hero. Completely dissolved. Not looking to God at all. And this is where he ends up. This points to the pressure that the Lord Jesus must have been under when all his enemies were after him, you know? King David failed under the pressure. King Jesus kept looking to God to the end. We'll look at that in a moment. But what's our application from this text? I mean, we look at chapter 21, and it's like, okay, but what about my life? What about now? Well, don't do what David did. Okay, well, thank you, Pastor. That's helpful. Have a good day. There's really not a lot to go on from the text itself. But if we look at what David learned from this experience, then all of a sudden, this text gets pretty encouraging. Turn over to the Psalms. Psalm 56. The title to this song says, "A Miktam of David, when the Philistines seized him in Gath." David wrote Psalm 56 in response to the circumstances that we've just read in chapter 21. Notice what David says. Ryan read this to us in our worship set. "Be gracious to me, O God, for man tramples on me all day long. An attacker oppresses me. My enemies trample on me all day long, for many attack me proudly. Hey, hey, isn't this the one of which they have sang, 'Saul killed his thousands, but David his 10,000s? This is the guy. This is the Philistine killer right here. We got him. Boy, are we proud of ourselves. When I am afraid, I put my trust in you." You know, it's easy when you read the Psalms and you read something like that in the Scriptures and you go, yeah, well, that's nice, but you don't know how difficult my circumstances are. But when you understand how difficult the circumstances were in which David wrote it, standing before the king of Gath, recognizing that he's going to be dead, and he says, okay, I was afraid there. I was very afraid. I had my moment of clarity. And I put my trust in the Lord. Wow. In God whose word I praise, in God I trust, I shall not be afraid. What can flesh do to me? And he remembers his covenant with God. In his fear, he has learned to put his trust in the Lord. When you are afraid, may you and I learn that it's at those times that we need most to put our trust in the Lord. That God is bigger than our circumstances. And God delivered him. We know that from the story. Turn back just a few pages to Psalm 34. This is the second psalm that David wrote. So two of the 150 psalms are written as a result of 1 Samuel 21. This one is so that when he changes behavior before Abimelech, or Achish, it's the same guy, so that he drove him out and he went away. "I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth." And you jump down to verse 4. "I sought the Lord and he answered me and he delivered me from all my fears." Verse 6. "This poor man cried and the Lord heard him and he saved him out of all his troubles." Summary. David is saying, even in my stupidity and foolishness to be operating on my own, apart from my God, even in the midst of that, he never let go of me. I came to a moment of clarity. I called out to my God, and he delivered me. God, his covenant name, Yahweh never lets go of his children. The Apostle Paul wrote about this in Romans chapter 8, 38 and 39. "For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord." And in that, everything else is my stupidity, my rebellion, my capacity to take my eyes off of God and do things in my own strength, apart from him, apart from him, from his wisdom. And even in the midst of that, I can call out to him, and he never lets go. And he never lets go. So in your suffering, and we will suffer on this earth, trust in God alone. And so what does this look like on a practical level? Our propensity, as we've talked about, is to take our eyes off of God. And what we need is people in our lives that when that happens, will place our eyes back on Him. I need that. You need that. And then we can be that blessing to others. When circumstances of this life, when a storm strikes a friend's life, and they're mentally discombobulated, and their eyes have been knocked off of God, and they're not thinking straight, and they're doing things in their own strength, we can lovingly and gently come alongside and go, our God's a big God. He's bigger than this. He can be trusted in this. I know it's confusing. I know it hurts. I know it's not fair. But God is able to work with it. And so our job becomes to place our brother's or sister's mind back on the King. That there is a God who loves him. And it might appear because of the circumstances that somewhere he let go. And they're feeling it. I guarantee you they're feeling it. And we can go to Psalm 56. We can go to Psalm 34. We go, Let's call out to him together. And together, let's help keep our eyes on this King Jesus, on this God. Amen? Amen. And so as you do that, with family, with friends, with your children, circumstances, a storm strikes your family's life, the best thing you can do, Dad, is say, kids, here's what's going on, and I'm afraid. And in the midst of my fear, as a family, we're going to choose to trust God with this. And give it some distance and watch what God does. And then you can point back and say, remember, he's faithful. Look what God did. Look what God did. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your word to us today. We thank you for this reality that you never let go of your children. And Lord, we would pray that by your Spirit, you would help us in the midst of our suffering to learn, as David did, to trust in you alone. And to become the type of people that can come alongside and minister to others, not with some trite, nice phrases, you know, God's good and all of that, but because we've walked with you through suffering, we can go, no, I've learned how to do this myself. And if you'll allow me, I'll walk with you through this. God's bigger than these circumstances. And so we would ask that you would make us that kind of a Christ follower. In Jesus' name, amen. Be a blessing this week. Love you guys. See you next week.